Harper Wave and Harper Audio present Hidden Brilliance, Unlocking the Intelligence of Autism by Lynn Kern Koegel, PhD, and Claire LaZebnik. Read by Emma Love. Dedicated to our families, whose support is unflagging and unconditional, with extra gratitude to our neurodiverse relatives and friends, whose stories and brilliance light up our lives and the pages of this book. Preface. We started writing books together about autism more than 20 years ago, and Lynn has been part of the autism world for a couple of decades longer than that. We've both seen a lot of autism-related trends, treatments, attitudes, and assumptions come and go, and it's always a relief to see outdated and misguided ideas disappear from the conversation. Overall, the changes in the last 20 years or so have been positive. Although the research is still woefully inadequate, there's more than there used to be to help guide us toward better ways to help individuals on the autism spectrum reach their full potential. Additionally, the way we think and talk about autism has changed, and there's more awareness about the importance and benefits of diversity and tolerance in our communities. We're thrilled that so many people are willing to open their hearts and minds to those who may look, talk, worship, and/or love differently than they do, and we're saddened and frustrated by those who aren't willing to take that leap. There are many wonderful and brilliant people with autism who are pushing for acceptance on their own terms and who, justifiably and rightfully, have no desire to be forced to conform to other people's expectations or rules. We heartily support that. No one should have to change who they are to make other people more comfortable. We also feel that connection to others and being part of a community is a vital, meaningful part of life, and that everyone should have the opportunity to know these joys. Sometimes this involves learning something new. A simple metaphor might be traveling to another country for an extended stay. If you never learn the language or customs, you might feel isolated, and you won't be exposed to new ideas and activities that could be life-changing. But if you make the effort to learn enough about your new home to be able to interact with the people who live there and to become part of their community, you will not only enrich your own life, but you will enrich the society around you by sharing your own different and potentially mind-opening viewpoints with others. Learning a new language doesn't eradicate or invalidate your original native language. It simply adds to it. Nor does learning about the customs of the people around you mean you have to conform to them, if you prefer your own, although you may discover you want to adopt some of the things you've learned about. Knowledge of other cultures simply creates a bridge between you and everyone around you, and you are all richer for it. Connection and diversity make every society wiser, kinder, more welcoming, and just better. Everything in this book is to help our children, our communities, and our world find the meaningful connections that open hearts and minds. What we're talking about when we talk about teaching methods. An important concept throughout this book is the importance of motivation. Motivational strategies are tried and true teaching procedures that should be used with all children. They play a fundamental role in bringing out anyone's potential. We'll be discussing them in far greater detail later in the book. But for now, just understand that by motivational strategies, we're referring to engaging and delighting a child, adolescent, or adult by using their unique interests and strengths when teaching them. We all learn best when we're interested in what we're studying and having fun. Feeling bored or being threatened with punishment will never spur anyone to greater involvement by choice. Being fascinated and discovering inherent rewards in every lesson will. Our goal in writing this book is to provide everyone with the opportunity to reach their maximum potential by focusing on motivational ways of teaching and by educating the larger community in supporting, accepting, and embracing the gifts autistic individuals offer. A few quick notes about language. As far as we can tell, Some members of the autism community prefer to be described as autistic, and others prefer the terms having autism or being on the autism spectrum, while there are those who prefer the more general person with ASD, and so on. If there were a final consensus of the most respectful way to identify members of this community, we would absolutely stick to that. But since we find opinions vary, we've also chosen to vary the terms we use in this book. Whether that means no one will find fault with us or everyone will find fault with us remains to be seen. We imagine we'll end up somewhere in the middle. Also, you may notice as you read through the book, and even this foreword, that we lean heavily on the pronoun they as a general use pronoun, even when we're using a singular subject, something we were both taught not to ever do when we were kids. We were also taught not to split an infinitive, so maybe we're just born rebels. A strict grammarian may be frustrated by sentences like, visit your child's classroom and get to know their teacher. And we get it. It does sound odd to older ears, but we'd rather sound odd and be inclusive of anyone and everyone, no matter how they identify, than exclude anyone. Saying he or she or they over and over again would get awfully cumbersome after a while. So they it is. We also hope that readers will forgive us the laziness of using the term parents when referring to any and all guardians and or caregivers responsible for the welfare and upbringing of a child. We understand that many who love and care for autistic children are grandparents, aunts, uncles, siblings, foster parents, etc., and we recognize that families come in all shapes and sizes. Once again, we're choosing a simple solution to keep the word count brief. And parent is just our shorthand for the child's caregiver, whoever that may be. Repetition. If you read this book straight through from beginning to end, you'll gain a certain familiarity with some of our key concepts. You may even feel like we're repeating ourselves a bit. That's because a lot of what's true for supporting your child in one area will be equally valid for supporting them in another. For example, as we explained above, we believe in motivating your child to stay engaged by incorporating their favorite toys, interests, and activities into every learning opportunity. So references to motivational procedures crop up quite a bit in the book, and we're likely to throw in a quick reminder/explanation of what that means almost every time we mention them. If something's an important thing to note and remember in one area, it's probably going to be equally important in another, and we'd rather hammer these things home than risk being unclear. Support for all. Over the last decade or so, it has become increasingly challenging to figure out the right tone for a book about autism that's aimed at parents of children on the spectrum. Parents and educators are often struggling with a child's interfering behaviors and communication challenges. They deserve empathy and support, but the autism advocacy movement has understandably and rightfully been working hard to combat negative stereotypes and anti-autism sentiments. It's a delicate balance to advise without giving offense. Above all, we want to help people find the connections that enrich their lives, and we definitely want to do this in a way that's enjoyable for everyone involved. Please understand that our intention is to support every member of every family to the best of our abilities, and to encourage love, success, celebration, and triumphs. We both have close relatives on the autism spectrum, and are always mindful of the work still needed to ensure good teaching, thoughtful learning environments, acceptance, and tolerance. Our goal is to identify the gifts and potential that must be nurtured, fostered, encouraged, and supported for the most successful learning and outcomes. We hope you find this book helpful in every possible way. Chapter 1. Hidden Strengths. Joey can draw a character from any TV show he's seen in about 3 seconds. He's only 5, and this totally impresses his friends. Andrew can name any movie theme song after just 2 notes. His peers beg the teacher to let him display his skills for the class. Arturo knows every train and airplane route in the world by heart. He loves to give advice, so family and friends consult him before they travel. Megan and Diego have no spoken words, but she can locate tiny hidden pictures in any drawing, and he can find his favorite app on his mom's phone in mere moments. Julia has memorized all the liner notes to every song by her favorite artist. Every year, the kids nominate her to be in the school talent show, and then argue about who'll get to introduce her. All of these children are autistic, and also undeniably brilliant. Recognizing a child's exceptional abilities is crucial for developing and achieving social communication goals. We want everyone reading this book to focus on the brilliance in the child in front of them, to delight in that child's strengths, to nurture their talents, and to brag about their triumphs. The rewards of doing this range from improving your own emotional life to being able to encourage others to bring out the best in your child, to knowing you can support them in a far more positive and successful way than one based on ferreting out weaknesses and deficits. Simply switching from the mindset of focusing on the negative to finding and focusing on the positives will have enormous impacts in every area of your family's life. This book will serve as a guide to identifying the brilliance and talents of your child and using them to engage, support, and teach your child in a way that everyone will find enjoyable and successful. Determining areas of strength and incorporating them into activities will elevate your child's learning, socialization, engagement, and happiness. Most parents feel certain that their kids are smarter than their scores and grades might indicate. Whether or not that's true is, of course, often up for debate. On the one hand, testing can be unreliable. On the other hand, we parents are a biased group. But when you're talking about children on the autism spectrum, as well as those with many other developmental differences, the odds are extremely high that their parents' suspicions are correct, and their kids are significantly brighter and more capable than testing, classroom performance, and traditional academic achievement are likely to show. The intelligence and abilities of children and young adults on the autism spectrum are too often overlooked and misjudged by those who rely on evaluation methods that don't take into account neurodiverse ways of learning, communicating, and behaving. Professionals present standardized test results to parents as some kind of predictor of future success, or lack thereof, with no acknowledgement of how flawed the system is for anyone with differences. Or, in some cases, the child may have acquired the skill the test is designed to tease out, but the testing materials and/or pictures differ from what the child is familiar with, which prevents them from answering correctly, which they might have done if different, more familiar stimuli had been presented. As a result, students with differences who are fully capable of doing interesting and meaningful schoolwork are instead frequently given tasks and problems below their abilities. In this book, we'll explore the reasons, both obvious and subtle, why this is true, and why it's vital that we challenge the conclusions people draw about our kids. We'll also discuss the many ways that teachers, administrators, diagnosticians, therapists, other professionals, and most crucially, family members can discover, nurture, and utilize a child's interests, strengths, and passions, not only to make a difference each and every day, but also to improve long-term outcomes. There are numerous authenticated ways to help autistic children, adolescents, and adults embrace, enjoy, and make the most of their intelligence and understanding, leading to fulfilling experiences and outcomes. We're going to be exploring those in this book, using real-life stories of individuals with ASD who were capable of far more than the adults around them realized, and whose innate brilliance and sensitivity, once recognized and encouraged, blossomed. A note: while the anecdotes are all true, names have been changed to protect everyone's privacy. Too often in the autism world, people can fall into the habit of focusing on unwanted or different behaviors. It's understandable. There's a tendency to feel like we need to fix weaknesses or deficits, and that idea can lead to searching them out. But, as we'll explain, strengths work as a springboard to learning and engagement, and should be where our focus lies. These positives might take a bit more effort to home in on, but they're there, and once identified, can create an entirely different trajectory for a child. Lynn's personal story. A little history. Teddy, a pseudonym, was a beautiful but extremely fussy baby. Whether it was colic or the initial signs of autism spectrum disorder, we'll never know. But many parents of children who are later diagnosed with autism report excessive and persistent crying in the early years. This isn't universal by any means. Many others report an extremely calm baby. And while we didn't think anything of it then, retrospectively, he fit the bill. At the time, though, we left it at fussy baby. I like to think that over the years, I've developed a pretty good instinct for quickly assessing an infant for autism. Do they make eye contact? Smile? Coo? Show interest in people? Laugh? Make back and forth vocalizations? I've studied all the proper milestones and early signs, so I've asked myself 100 times why it took me so long to notice that my own nephew was on the spectrum. To be fair to myself, our family parties are chaotic, with tons of socializing and kids running around. Teddy didn't get wild or demand attention. He usually just played quietly with one of his favorite train sets. He didn't have any outward repetitive behaviors that were noticeable at a family party, so nothing immediately drew my attention, although his intense engagement with the trains would eventually lead to issues with sharing in preschool. Then one day, another relative expressed concern that Teddy wasn't talking enough for a child who was about to turn 2. She also was worried because he repeatedly turned her electric blanket on and off for hours and became upset when redirected. This repetitive behavior, coupled with his communication delay, caught my attention. At our next family gathering, I made a point of joining Teddy on the floor, where he was playing with his train set, pushing the cars around the track. "Wow, awesome trains," I said, but he didn't look up or acknowledge me. I pointed to the first one in his row and said, "Is that Thomas?" No response. I picked Percy up from the pile of cars Teddy wasn't using, and he immediately screamed, grabbed the car out of my hand, and put it back in its previous location. Teddy was nonverbal, didn't respond to a comment or point, and got upset when I attempted to join his play and change his routine. His behavior certainly fit the description of ASD. I tried again to interact with him at the next family gathering, but every time I reached out, he reacted with the same deafening scream. It was time to ask his parents to bring him in for an assessment. The next week, my suspicions were confirmed. No language, check. No social interaction, check. No interest in others, check. Repetitive behaviors, check. Lining up items, check. No joint attention, no sharing of joy, no following a point, and on and on and on. Check, 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 check. Along with these symptoms of autism, Teddy had screaming meltdowns every time something didn't go his way. As gently as I could, I suggested to his worried parents that we start a specialized program of support for autism. The assessment. To confirm the diagnosis and secure services, 2 clinicians were assigned by the state of California's regional center system to meet with us at Teddy's home to observe him. Note, some states do not have or no longer rely on state agencies, as most states require insurance companies to provide coverage for autism services. Your pediatrician can guide you to or assist with a private evaluation. You can also contact your local school district for guidance and an evaluation to assess whether your child is eligible for services. One of Teddy's evaluators was an experienced middle-aged preschool specialist. The other was an inexperienced early childhood specialist who walked in with a clipboard and immediately started shooting off rote questions. Did he meet his early milestones? When did he crawl, sit up, walk? They asked if we could try to get Teddy to talk. One of his favorite toys was a complicated set of ramps that balls could roll down. So I picked up one of the balls as it came through and modeled the word ball for him. Enormously upset that I had interrupted his activity, he screamed, picked up the maze of tunnels, and threw it on the floor. Parts scattered everywhere. The Observer's Fever.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.